Shabbat Shalom. We're glad that you could join us today. We're live streaming from Burney, Texas, and we just love being here. We've missed everybody here, but we miss all of you in California and New Mexico. We have people watching from Mexico. We want to just say Shabbat Shalom to all of you that are watching. We're excited about today's teaching, and we're excited that you were able to join us. So I'm going to open in prayer. Heavenly Father, we just thank you. Abba, your word says, wherever two or more are gathered in your name, not hundreds, but even two or more gathered in your name, that you are in the midst of us. And Father, you call us into community. And so often it's hard to have that community. But today, Father, we come before your presence in your throne room of grace by the power of the blood of your only begotten Son. And we thank you for your presence, Father. We thank you for your word that you are washing us, your bride, with water by your word. And so it's so important, Father, that we study your word as we wash ourselves and prepare ourselves for the second coming of our bridegroom, Yeshua HaMashiach. So we give you honor, glory, and praise today, Abba. Father, we thank you that you will speak from your heart through my mouth to the hearts and the minds of your people today, your bride, as you have a chesed love for your bride, that love that is covenantal, generational, going from one generation to the next. We thank you for this chesed love that you have for us, your bride. In Yeshua's name, amen and amen. Well, today we're going to be studying from the book of Esther. So if you have your Bibles, you can turn to the book of Esther. We're going to be talking about Purim. Now, we need to understand Purim is not a high holy day that we find in Leviticus 23, where Jehovah told Moses to tell the children of Israel that this is his holy days, his times, set times to meet with his people. So there are high holy days in Leviticus 23 that we're commanded to keep. And it's so beautiful because it's so prophetic of our Messiah. If we really study these days and understand Yeshua HaMashiach has fulfilled everything Moses wrote about him. So in these high holy days in Leviticus 23, we find his birth at the Feast of Tabernacles, his death, his hanging on the execution stake in Passover as our Passover lamb. He rose the third day, which is the Feast of First Fruits, and we're called the first fruits. He is the first fruit of resurrection. Then we see Shavuot 50 days later, Pentecost, where the baptism of the Holy Spirit came in Jerusalem upon the Jewish people. And that's the fullness of the baptism of the Holy Spirit. They were the first Pentecostals. We see he's our high priest at the Day of Atonement. So Yeshua has fulfilled all these beautiful feast days, and it's very prophetic of his birth, his death, his resurrection, and the baptism of the Holy Spirit, how he's given us a new heart and given us the power of his Holy Spirit to follow his loving instructions. The only thing he didn't fulfill so far is Rosh Hashanah, the new year, the blowing of the shofar. And many believers believe that's the day that he will return at the trumpet blast. So we see that these are beautiful holy days, but today we're going to talk about Purim. And Purim is so amazing because it was a miracle. And we see in the book of Esther that it's a miracle that took place. And it's a memorial, an understanding that Jehovah, the Elohim of Israel, is still very interested in his creation. And so it's so important that we look at the book of Esther. I hear many times people say, well, why do we Christians study anything to do with the Jews? Well, the first thing, we're grafted into Israel. We have to understand that Paul told us that we are grafted into the olive tree. And because we're grafted into Israel, this is our history. We go back all the way back to Abraham. And it's important for us to understand, as believers in Messiah, Yeshua HaMashiach, the Jewish Messiah, that we are grafted into the olive tree, which is Israel. We're not separate. We haven't replaced Israel. We are grafted in. So these, literally, we go back to Abraham. Father Abraham had many sons. Many sons had Father Abraham. We go all the way back to him, and the promises, the covenant that Elohim of Israel made with Abraham, and he is not a liar. Our Elohim of Israel didn't lie. He didn't change his mind. He said Abraham would be a father of many nations. And we Gentiles, if we're not Jewish, we're grafted in through a Jewish bridegroom, Yeshua HaMashiach, Jesus of Nazareth. The second thing, it's our history too. The church, the Christian church, or our believers in Messiah, didn't start in the New Testament. I hear some churches say, we're just New Testament. Precious ones, your salvation didn't start at the New Testament. It started in Genesis, when God created us in his image for relationship. He's the king of the universe, and he wants relationship with us. And we see throughout history how he's been faithful at coming after his creation, his bride, to wash us, to have relationship with us. We're called the bride of Christ. And he has gone after us from generation to generation with his chesed love. The fourth reason I love studying the Tanakh, the Old Testament, it's history. And we need to understand history repeats itself. And I need to say that again. There's nothing new under the stars. There's nothing new under heaven. History repeats itself. So when we look at the book of Esther, we're going to see some different things, how history is repeating itself over and over again, and even possibly continuing to repeat itself in the future for us as believers. We're going to also see spiritual warfare, as I teach a lot on spiritual warfare and pass down generational curses or bloodline things that go down the bloodline. I want you to pay attention today to today's teaching, because we're going to see some things that started all the way back with Abraham that's continuing today all the way down through the history and to us and probably future history. We're going to see something. How many of you listen to the teachings that God turns everything around for good? That all the hell we go through, God can turn around for good. And we're going to see in the book of Esther today that even though they were under attack and Satan wanted to destroy the Jewish nation, God turned it around. Precious ones, this is a miracle. We need to look at this miracle and really understand who the Messiah is and who Elohim of Israel is and how he is continuing today in our lives, that as we call to him, how we even read in Psalms 91, he's given his angels charge over us. And so we're going to look at the book of Esther today. So if you've turned your Bibles to Esther, for time purposes, I'm going to probably skip through, but I so recommend you go home and, or you read it today, or read it sometimes this week. We just came through Purim a couple of days ago, so it's very appropriate that we look at the book of Esther and find out why we celebrate such a day, and it's a good day. Now, the world is celebrating pagan days. They're celebrating on Halloween, a high day of Satan, a horrible day, that you would even put your children in these horrible costumes of devils and witches, or you would have these little girls dress up in these sexy outfits, and how horrible to have them participate in Halloween. But if you understand Purim, and we at Without Spot or Wrinkle Ministries in Laverne, we celebrate Purim and we celebrate our children, and we let them dress up in good costumes, and we give them candy, and this is a celebration that's a holy day and not a evil demonic day. So I really encourage you, if you want to let your children have good and have candy and dress up in costumes, let's celebrate Purim in the body of Christ. It's a holy day, not a demonic day. So we're going to start in the book of Esther. And at chapter 1, we see that the king celebrated. He had a celebration of 180 days. Talk about a partier. He had only been on the throne for 3 years. And he threw he brought all these people in and showed them all his treasures and everything for 180 days. I don't think I could party that long. Then we see a 7-day party. A 7-day party, and talk about decorations. I think of some of the women here, I know here in Bernie, we have some beautiful women that know how to decorate and really make things great here when we have celebrations. But we see that this king knew how to celebrate, and he knew how to decorate. It tells us all the furnishings, and everything was so over the top and so beautiful. But they also all just got drunk and could drink as much as they wanted. Can you imagine drinking as much as you want for 7 days of alcohol? And I think that by that time I would probably be throwing up. But here we see this party on top of a party of 7 full days. And the king obviously is feeling no pain. And he's already shown all of these men the beauty and look at me and look where I'm at and look how rich I am. Bring my wife. I want you guys to see my beautiful wife. Well, she refused. She was having a party for the women, and really kind of in those days, I don't think they really kind of blended, but she didn't want to go and be paraded in front of all these drunk men, and she chose to say no. Now, this was a big deal for the king, because you have to remember his heart was full of wine, and he was prideful and arrogant, and he wanted to show his wife off too. And when she said no, it rattled the whole country. It rattled everything. And he had his advisors come and say, you know what? If she disrespected you like that in front of all these men, all the women are going to disrespect their husbands in their own households. We need to do something about this. So they decided to dethrone Vashti. They decided that queen had to go. Then the king, after he sobered up, he realized what happened, and he didn't have a wife anymore. So they decided that they would find all the virgins in the town and parade them after they gave them a year beauty treatment. Now we have to understand something as believers. Do you know that God will make a place for you? That he takes people out of position to put you in position. When he needs you to line up for something for his kingdom, you're going to be put in positions that you never thought possible. And some of those positions might be very uncomfortable. We see that Esther was a beautiful woman, a virgin. Her cousin was raising her because she had no mother and father. She probably had some heartaches over that, you think? And so then she had to go to the king's place and literally almost be like kidnapped and be treated in these beauty treatments knowing that she had to go before the king, but the spirit of the living God was in her. And she had not only an outer beauty, but an inner beauty. Now, I kind of relate a little bit. One time I had to go back waitressing and I hated it. I didn't like the position I was in. But you know, after 2 years of hell in my life, I met my Boaz, Reverend Ben. And one person had to leave in order to put me in that position, because God knew where I was going to be today with my wonderful husband, Reverend Ben, amen, and my Boaz. Amen. So we see that God has purpose and plan for all of our lives. And sometimes the position we're in is uncomfortable. We don't want to be there. But there is an assignment from our Heavenly Father where He's called us. And so Queen Esther, Hadassah is her Jewish name. But they didn't let people know she was Jewish. Her cousin said, hey, don't let people know everything. Now, this woman was not only beautiful, like I said, on the outside, she was beautiful on the inside, because we see that she found favor. She found favor everywhere she goes within this year beauty treatment. Precious ones, it's important that the Holy Spirit causes us to be beautiful on the inside and outside, because she knew how to answer these people. She had a heart of compassion. She had a gentleness to her. She wasn't overpowering. She wasn't demanding. And she found favor with the people that were above her. And they really went out of their way to give her more, because she was so beautiful inside and out, and she found favor. We can find favor when we have the Holy Spirit and we let the Holy Spirit take care of our tongue and give us that beauty from inside out. So we see that she was chosen over all the other women. And we see that in chapter 2. Esther becomes queen. So God dethroned one and put Esther, a Jewish person. Now, this was in Persia. So I want you to see today where Persia was or is today. It's Iran. And all of the Jewish people had been taken captive because they followed after false gods, and God allowed their captors to take them captive. But then they settled down. And they stayed in that place, in that region, because they had built houses. They had gotten married. They had children. They had jobs. So why get up and go back to Israel? Besides, Israel was a mess. It was torn down. The wall was torn down. The temple was torn up. And it was a mess. So why move when it was comfortable? So we have to see that they had already had a life there in Iran, and decided not to go back to Israel. But we see now that we see Hadassah, the Jewish woman here, now becomes queen of a pagan nation. And we, you know, sometimes I have to agree with some people when they say, be careful when you get married, you're unevenly yoked. And I agree with that. But I also understand sometimes God puts us in positions where we need to be at a certain time in a certain place. And this was a pagan king. So if she would have heard, you can't marry him, how would she have felt at that time? But God created that situation for her. So we see now that it pleased the king for her to become the queen. Let's go to verse 5, because I want to point something out really clearly to you. In Shushan the Citadel, there was a certain Jew whose name was Mordecai, the son of Jar, the son of Shammai, the son of Kish, a Benjamite. Kish had been carried away from Jerusalem with the captives who had been captured. The king of Judah from Nebuchadnezzar, the king of Babylon, had carried away. So who is the son of Benjamite? Benjamin was the youngest son of Israel. And if you remember the story, he had 12 sons and Benjamin was the youngest. And you'll read throughout scripture that people will say, but I'm the least of the least of them. So many of us feel the least of the least. But you'll hear them say, I'm in the line of Benjamin. And so King Saul, before he became king, when Samuel was told to ordain him as king, he was curious. It's like, why are you talking to me like this? I'm the least of the least of them. And he was in the line of Benjamin. So we see here in 1 Samuel 9, if you want to turn there, you can, but you can also just listen. 1 Samuel 9. And this is when Saul was chosen to be king. There was a man of Benjamin whose name was Kish, the son of Abidel, the son of Zeror, and a Benjamite, a mighty man of power. And he had a choice, an handsome son whose name was Saul. So we see Saul was in the line of Benjamin. So kind of make an asterisk there in your mind. Kind of put that aside for a minute, because we're going to talk about that in a few minutes even more. So we see that verse 7, and Mordecai had brought up Hadassah, that is Esther, his uncle's daughter, for she had neither father nor mother. The young woman was lovely and beautiful. When her father and mother died, Mordecai took her as his own daughter. So we see the cousin, Mordecai, which was in the line of Benjamin, had taken Hadassah, and he named her Esther. Actually, Esther comes from the god of Ashtaroth. So that's where we get the name of Esther, which is kind of unusual for him to have named her that and her being Jewish. She did not reveal the people that she was from or her family because Mordecai had told her not to. Go down to verse 19, because this one is important. And I'm trying to get all through the whole book without reading it all, because there's so much to read. Verse 19, when virgins were gathered together a second time, Mordecai sat within the king's gate. Now Esther had not revealed her family and her people, just as Mordecai had charged her. For Esther obeyed at the command of Mordecai, as when she was brought up by him. So she was under delegated authority. She knew delegated authority, and she respected and had reverence for people that were in delegated authority over her. Verse 21, in those days while Mordecai sat within the king's gate, two of the king's eunuchs, doorkeepers, became furious and sought to lay hands on King Ahasuerus. So the matter became known to Mordecai, who told Queen Esther, and Esther informed the king in Mordecai's name. And when an inquiry was made into the matter, it was confirmed, and both were hanged on gallows. And it was written in the book of the Chronicles in the presence of the king. Now after these things, I'm in chapter 3, verse 1, King Ahasuerus promoted Haman, the son of the Agagite, and advanced him and set his seat above all the princes who were with him. And all the king's servants were within the king's gate, bowed and paid homage to Haman, for so the king had commanded concerning him. But Mordecai would not bow or pay homage. So let's turn to Deuteronomy 25, 17 through 19, because who was Haman, a Gagite? He was in the line of an Amalekite, and that is one of the things I want to talk to you about today is the Amalekite. I call it the Amalekite spirit. So Deuteronomy 25, 17 through 19 says, remember that Amalekite, remember what Amalekite did to you on the way as you were coming out of Egypt. how he met you on the way and attacked your rear guard, your rear ranks, all the stragglers at your rear. When you were tired and weary, listen to these words. He did not fear God. Therefore, it shall be when the Lord your God has given you rest from your enemies all around in the land which the Lord your God is giving you to possess as an inheritance, that you will blot out the remembrance of Amalek from under heaven. You shall not forget. Now, Satan goes after the weak ones. When you're tired and weary in your Christian walk, and you're lagging far behind, when the Holy Spirit's doing something incredible, and you're spiritually asleep back there, you're going to be attacked strongly. He goes after the weak ones. He goes after the ones that's left the crowd. And it says, don't... that he calls us to have community and stay in community. But those that think that they don't need the community anymore and kind of come out here on their own, they're really a target for the enemy. And when they're tired and they're weary, and they're far back from what the Holy Spirit wants, so it's important that you stay following the Holy Spirit, what he wants, what he's doing in each season of time, because God's always doing something wonderful and another move, and we have to stay in step with what the Father is doing. So 1 Samuel 15, verse 1, Samuel also said to Saul, remember the Benjamite? The Lord sent me to anoint you king over his people, over Israel. Now therefore, heed the voice of the words of the Lord. Thus says the Lord of hosts, I will punish Amalek for what he did to Israel, how he ambushed him on the way when he came up from Egypt. Now go and attack Amalek and utterly destroy all that they have and do not spare them, but kill both man and woman, infant and nursing child, ox and sheep, camel and donkey. That sounds really harsh. Mm-hmm. It sounds horrible. But we have to understand how demons follow the bloodline. So Saul gathered the people together and numbered them, 200,000 foot soldiers and 10,000 men of Judah. And Saul came to the city of Amalek and lay in wait in the valley. Then Saul said to the Kenites, go, depart, get down from among the Amalekites, lest I destroy you with them, for you show kindness to all the children of Israel when they came up from Egypt. So Canaanites departed among the Amalekites, and Saul attacked the Amalekites. He also took Agag, king of the Amalekites, alive. So history kind of shows, if you study a little bit of this history, kind of what the rabbis talk about in different things, that this king was brought, and also the choice animals were brought when Saul was to kill them all, not take anyone. And it's so incredible how Saul was disobedient. He actually lost the kingdom at that point in time. And it says obedience is better than sacrifice. He was more afraid of the people because he said the people wanted this. And so he was disobedient to the king of the universe. It is so important when God tells us something that we do exactly what God tells us to with no excuses. He said disobedience is the same as witchcraft. Disobedience to the voice of God is the same as witchcraft. So Saul lost the kingdom because he did what the people wanted. And this is a real message for pastors today. We can't give the people what they want. We have to give them what God wants them to have, because Amen. He's washing them with the word. He's cleansing us. He's purifying us. And our babies, our spiritual babies, they want milk. They want to have fun. They want to go out and play. But it's important that they line up to the anointing of the living God, because he's doing something incredible for future generations. I need to say that again. When God tells us something, it's not just for our generation, because we plant a seed that will go down from generation to generation to generation. As we see here now in the book of Esther, we see the Amalekite spirit. Now, what is the Amalekite spirit? Let's turn to Genesis 28:9. So Esau went to Ishmael and took Mahlath, the daughter of Ishmael, Abraham's son, the sister of Nebajoth, to be his wife in addition to the wives he had. So Esau is Jacob's brother. They were twins in Rebekah's belly, and God said it was two nations. They were fighting inside the belly. Ishmael is the firstborn of Abraham through the handmaiden of Sarah. They had an Ishmael. Now, who is Ishmael? What does all this have to do with us today? Ishmael should have received the firstborn blessing. Now, when you start understanding the Hebrew roots of our faith, the firstborn son gets double portion, gets the firstborn blessing. There's a lot more given to the firstborn because there's a lot more responsibility for the firstborn. But Ishmael was the firstborn, and now Isaac got the blessing from his father, not Ishmael. So we see that Isaac got double portion. Isaac's wife, Rebekah, was pregnant with twins. We see them fighting in her womb. She asked God, "What in the world's going on inside of me?" And he says, "You've got two nations inside of you." So Ishmael is the firstborn, but Jacob stole the birthright, or got the birthright. Ishmael sold it. Then he got the blessing as the firstborn. And we see he got all of the promises. Curses and blessings are very real. And we see he gets all of the blessings of Israel, of Abraham, the covenant of God telling Abraham he was going to bring his descendants 400 years back to Canaan, which happens to be Israel. So we see now Ishmael marries the daughter, Esau marries the daughter of Ishmael, and they have a son. That son is Amalekite. Now that son, we have to see they hate Israel. It started all the way back up with Abraham. Anti-Semitic started all the way back. Ishmael is, the bloodline of Ishmael goes down to the Muslims. The bloodline of Isaac goes to the Jews, and we're grafted into that as Gentiles because we're grafted into Israel. So we see generational hatred, a root of bitterness, of jealousy, of real hatred. So when the children of Israel came out of Egypt 400 years later, they had this enemy of the Amalekites. And the Amalekites is anti-Semitic. And precious ones, we need to be careful in the body of Messiah, because there's a lot of anti-Semitic in the body of Messiah as believers, that we didn't replace Israel. We didn't replace them, and they're not taken out. We are grafted into them. So when we get angry, I know my grandmother say, "Those Jews killed my Jesus." No, Jesus laid his life down. Yeshua laid his life down for our salvation as the blood that was shed for our sins. And so we have to be careful with this anti-Semitic in the body of Christ. When we start understanding our Hebrew roots, and people say, "Oh, you can't do that. That's legalistic, and we're not Jews. Are you becoming Jewish?" And it's such a foul word almost coming out of them. Your Messiah, Jesus, in John 4, says Yeshua is it, salvation comes through the Jews. And if you've accepted Jesus as your Savior, He is Jewish and he's your Jewish bridegroom. So we have to be careful how we listen to the world and not to the Father where he's taking us. Because learning our Hebrew roots is a move of the Holy Spirit. It's a reformation of grafting us back in where we belong. And that, do we love all Jewish people? Probably not. But this is your history. And this is what we need to be paying attention to. Amen?
Amen.
So back to Esther chapter 3. Then the king's servants who were within the king's gate said to Mordecai, "Why do you transgress the king's command?" Now it happened, when they spoke to him daily and he would not listen to them, that they told it to Haman to see whether Mordecai's words would stand. For Mordecai had told them that he was a Jew. When Haman saw that Mordecai did not bow or pay him homage, Haman was filled with wrath. But he disdained to lay hands on Mordecai alone, for they had told him of the people of Mordecai. Haman sought to destroy all the Jews who were throughout the whole kingdom, the people of Mordecai. Precious ones, I want you to understand laws can change really quick. Things can flip on us really quick in America, even as we're seeing Ukraine right now, how things have changed, and I believe that is an Amalekite spirit going after these innocent people, women, children, destroying the horribleness of watching that happen. Precious ones, don't think that we're in America and it can never happen to us. Laws are changing very quickly in America, and there's an anti-Semitic spirit, a Amalekite spirit on America that hates Israel, that hates the Jewish people, and a lot of the nations around us. It's anti-Semitic. Iran today speaks death to Israel and death to America. Laws can change that quick. So don't think that they can't. And that's why we study these, because history repeats itself. Verse 8, then Haman said to the king, "There's a certain people scattered and dispersed among the people in all the provinces of your kingdom. Their laws are different from all the other peoples, and they do not keep the king's laws." That kind of sounds a little bit like America today, doesn't it? "Therefore, it is not fitting for the king to let them remain. If it pleases the king, let a decree be written that they be destroyed. And I will pay 10,000 talents of silver into the hands of those who do the work to bring it into the king's treasuries." So we see that the king gave him his signet ring, and he was allowed to change the laws in the town to have all these Jewish people completely destroyed, women, children, everything completely annihilated. Now we go to Esther 4, starting at verse 1. When Mordecai learned that what all had happened, he tore his clothes and put on sackcloth and ashes and went out in the midst of the city. He cried out with a loud and bitter cry. I can imagine the heartache of Mordecai. When I see our TV today of what's happening in Ukraine, can you imagine the terror, the heartache of people being destroyed today, killed for no other reason because someone wants more property, more land, wants to control? He went as far as the front of the king's gate where no one might enter the king's gate clothed with sackcloth. And in every province where the king's command and decree arrived, there was great mourning among the Jews, with fasting, weeping, and wailing, and many lay in sackcloth and ashes. So Esther's maids and eunuchs came and told her, and the queen was deeply distressed. Then she sent garments to clothe Mordecai and take off his sackcloth, but he refused. Now, verse 7. And Mordecai told him, the young man that was helping Esther, that what all had happened to him and the sum of the money that Haman had promised to pay into the king's treasuries to destroy the Jews. He also gave him a copy of the written decree for their destruction, which was given at Shushan, that he might show it to Esther and explain to her, and that he might command her to go into the king to make supplication to him and plead before him for her people. So Hathish returned and told Esther the words of Mordecai. Then Esther spoke to Hathish and gave him a command for Mordecai. All the king's servants and the people of the king's provinces know that any man or woman who goes into the inner court to the king who has not been called, he has but one law: put all to death, except the one to whom the king holds out the golden scepter, that he may live. Yet I myself have not been called to go into the king these 30 days. So they told Mordecai Esther's words. And Mordecai told them to answer Esther, "Do not think in your heart that you will escape in the king's palace any more than all the other Jews. For if you remain completely silent at this time, relief and deliverance will arise for the Jews from another place. But you and your father's house will perish. Yet who knows? For rather you have come to the kingdom for such a time as this." I believe I'm speaking to the bride of Messiah today, that you have come to the kingdom for such a time as this. This is the most exciting time we can be alive, that we can go before the King of the universe, into his holy presence, into his throne room, by the power of the blood of Yeshua HaMashiach, our Jewish Messiah, and make our requests known. And I believe because of the blood that was shed for us that allows us access into the very throne room of the living God, the Elohim of Israel, that he will hold up his golden scepter for us because we're in his kingdom and we're his bride. Amen?
Amen.
Then Esther told them to reply to Mordecai, "Go gather all the Jews who are present and fast for me. Neither eat nor drink for 3 days, night or day. My maids and I will fast likewise. And so I will go to the king, which is against the law. And if I perish, I perish." I would be amiss if I didn't say how important fasting is. We ask for people in our family to be saved. We ask for things to happen, but are we even willing to give up one meal? Could we fast for a day, for 2 days? I know there's times where, Lord, I want something like someone saved, delivered, and I've gone into a fast, and my flesh doesn't like it very much, and I want to get out of that fast as I can. And the Lord will say something to me. How important is it of the request you're asking for? Can you give up a meal or two for a day or two for someone's salvation? When my father was a raging alcoholic, dirty old man, you guys might have heard my story, I wanted him saved. And I went into a fast. The first time I ever heard about fasting, and I fasted, I was going to fast the whole day and only made it to one. But in that fast, I stayed on my face before God the Father. And about 5 o'clock that day, I got a message that my father was dying. He had blood clots going through his lungs. And if I ever wanted to see him, I better get to the hospital. It was about an hour and a half away. And I was angry at God. I didn't know the power of God. And sometimes when you pray for things and are really serious, sometimes things get worse. And I was cussing God out literally all the way to the hospital, yelling at him, going, I said saving, don't killing. What are you doing up there? And a couple of weeks after the hospital stay, he made it through surgery. He told me he felt like he was going to die within about 3 months. And I told him, Dad, you can't die till you accept Jesus as Lord and Savior. And he said, I already have. And he started telling me, on that operating table, he died. And he had an out-of-body experience with Yeshua. And when he came back, he was a completely changed man. All the filth of pornography left his house. He brought in books of plants. And he didn't become a preacher or what someone would say, a Bible thumper. But he had changed. Something had changed in him. And he had gotten saved. That fasting and that prayer brought salvation to my father. So this is a lesson for us. If there's something you want changed, some people that you want saved, things that you want to happen, that's in agreement with God. He wants everyone saved. That if you fast and really go before the Father, you're going to see miracles happen. I have seen them in my own life. So Mordecai went away and did just as Queen Esther. And again, I believe that we, the bride of Christ, have been called for such a time as this. In our generation, if you're living in this generation, there's a call and purpose on your life.
Amen.
And Isaiah 60 says, to arise and shine, for your light has come. And the glory of the Lord has risen on you. For behold, the darkness shall cover the earth. It's a darkness covering the earth. And deep darkness the people. But the Lord will arise over you, and his glory will be seen upon you. The Gentiles shall come to your light, and the kings to the brightness of your rising. So you are the bride. You're called to the kingdom for such a time as this. And his glory is going to be released upon the bride in these last days like we've never seen before. Let's go back to Esther 5. Now it happened on the third day that Esther put on her royal robes and stood in the inner court of the king's palace across from the king's house. While the king sat on the royal throne of the house, I'm going to have to paraphrase and go faster here, I'm running out of time. She went before the king and he held up the golden scepter. And he said, what do you want, my dear? You can have up to half the kingdom. Now, Esther was a very intelligent woman because she didn't just blurt out all the stuff she thought. She had perfect timing. Women, let me speak something to you. There's a perfect timing to speak to your husband and to use wisdom when you have that timing. When he's tired and hungry, that's not the time to talk about things. There's a perfect timing and a way to speak it. And Queen Esther had this. She asked him to the first banquet, and then he's going, well, tell me what else you want. She goes, well, come to the second banquet. And she exposed Haman's devious evil that he was committing against her people. And she asked for it to be reversed. We got to go back, though. Before the second lunch or festival, the feast that she prepared for the king the next day. I love this part because pride goes before a fall. Let's go to Esther 6. So this is between the two luncheons that she invited her husband to. That night, the king could not sleep. So one was commanded. First, let me back up. Haman went home and was so excited and so prideful. He told his wife, oh my gosh, I was the only one invited with the king. And look at all this great stuff the king is bestowing on me. Remember, pride goes before a fall. So that night, the king could not sleep. So one was commanded to bring the book of records of the Chronicles. And they were read before the king. And it was found written that Mordecai had told of these two men that were going to kill the king. And the king says, what honor or dignity has been bestowed on Mordecai for doing this. And the king's servant who attended him said, nothing's been done for him. So the king said, who's in the court? I love how God sets things up. Now Haman had just entered the outer court of the king's palace to suggest that the king hang Mordecai on the gallows that he had prepared for him. The king's servant said to him, Haman is there, standing in the court. And the king said, let him come in. So Haman came in, and the king asked him, what shall be done for the man who the king delights to honor? Now Haman thought in his heart, whom would the king delight to honor more than me? And Haman answered the king, for the man whom the king delights to honor, let a royal robe be brought, which the king has worn, and a horse on which the king has ridden, which has a royal crest placed on his head. Then let this robe and the horse be delivered to the hand of one of the king's most noble princes, then that he may array the man whom the king delights to honor. Then parade him on horseback through the city square and proclaim before him, thus shall it be done to the man whom the king delights to honor. Then the king said to Haman, hurry, take the robe and the horse as you have suggested, and do so to Mordecai the Jew, who sits within the king's gate. Leave nothing undone of all that you have spoken. God turns everything around. So Haman took the robe and the horse, arrayed Mordecai, led him to the horseback through the city square, proclaimed before him, thus shall it be done to the man whom the king delights in honor. Can you imagine? Afterward, Mordecai went back to the king's gate, but Haman hurried to his house, mourning with his head covered. When Haman told his wife all of his friends, everything that had happened to him, his wise men and his wife said to him, if Mordecai, before whom you have begun to fall, is of Jewish descent, you will not prevail against him, but will surely befall before him. While they were still talking with him, the king's eunuchs came and hastened to bring Haman to the banquet which Esther had prepared. Then we see, I'm running out of time. So Esther exposes Haman. The king takes him on the very gallows that he wanted to hang Mordecai on. He was hang on with his 10 sons. And then Esther was given the ability with her uncle or her cousin to change the laws that the people could protect themselves, because they couldn't redo this law, because once it was law, they couldn't redo it. But they were able to give the people, the Jewish people, permission to protect themselves. All the people, the Jewish people, they protected themselves. They killed many, many people. So chapter 9, verse 1, on the day that the enemies of the Jews had hoped to overpower them, the opposite occurred, in that the Jews themselves overpowered those who hated them. Precious ones, I'm praying for Ukraine. I'm praying this very scripture will be the exact same thing, that they will be able to reverse what the enemy has planned, the Amalekite spirit has planned, to destroy this beautiful country and these people that did nothing wrong to the Russians or to Putin. So we see that they were able to fight. So many people were destroyed. So we go down to chapter 19. So after this battle was over, they fought and won. It says chapter 18, verse 18, but the Jews who were at Sishon assembled together on the 13th day as well as on the 14th. And on the 15th of the month, they rested and made it a day of feasting and gladness. Chapter 19, therefore the Jews of the villages who dwelt in the unwalled town celebrated the 14th day of the month of Adar with gladness and feasting as a holiday and for sending presents to one another. You want to spend money and buy gifts? This is the season to do it in. You can buy all the gifts and send it to everybody you want to. And Mordecai wrote these things and sent letters to all the Jews near and far who were in the province of the king to establish among them that they should celebrate yearly the 14th and 15th day of the month. Verse 22. I think I probably have you guys confused by now. As the days on which the Jews had rest from their enemies, as the month which was turned from sorrow to joy for them, and from mourning to holiday, that they should make them days of feasting and joy, of sending presents to one another and gifts to the poor. So the Jews accepted the custom which they had begun, as Mordecai had written to them, because Haman, the son of Hammedatha, the Agagite, the enemy of all the Jews, had plotted against the Jews to annihilate them and had cast pur, that is the lot, to consume them and destroy them. But when Esther came before the king, he commanded by letter that this wicked plot which Haman had devised against the Jews should return on his own head. And Father, we pray that on Putin. And that he and his son should be hanged on the gallows. So they called these days Purim, after the name of Pur. Therefore, because of the words of this letter, what they had seen concerning this matter and what had happened to them, the Jews established and imposed it upon themselves and their descendants and all who would join them. Have we been grafted into Israel? That without fail they would celebrate these days 2 days every year according to the written instructions and according to the prescribed time. That these days should be remembered and kept throughout every generation, every family, every province, every city, that these days of Purim should not fail to be observed among the Jews, and that the memory of them should not perish among their descendants. Then Queen Esther, the daughter of Abihail, with Mordecai the Jew, wrote with full authority to confirm the second letter about Purim. Verse 32, so the decree of Esther confirmed these matters of Purim, and it was written in the book. Why do we celebrate miracle days instead of counterfeit evil days? Because we're grafted into Israel. History repeats itself. That spirit of Amalekite is still alive today. Anti-Semitism, hating the Jewish people, and hating believers in Messiah. With that, I'm going to close and invite Pastor Anthony to come forward and bless us for the day. Heavenly Father, we thank you as we study these books and these festivals and these memorials and these miracles of you showing up when we're being destroyed. Father, we thank you. No weapon formed against us will prosper. That, Father, you will turn things around on our enemy. That you've said you've given your angels charge over us, and all things work together for good for those who love you and are called according to your purpose and plan. Father, you have called your bride into your kingdom for such a time as this, and you've poured out your anointing upon her that your glory will be seen amongst the nations. In Yeshua's holy name, amen and amen and amen. Pastor Anthony.
Bless the Lord with blessed. Bless the Lord with blessed forever and ever. Yevarechacha Adonai v'yifurecha. Ya'er Adonai panav alecha v'chunecha. Yisa Adonai panav alecha v'yisem lecha shalom. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord's countenance be upon you. May he be gracious to you, and let his countenance be upon you.
Yes.
And may he give you peace.
Amen.